So I will talk about a few topics between computer science and physics, generally around the Markov field. So Markov field in physics, it's known usually from Ising model. So we have some up and down spins, and they have some preference in ferromagnetic disease, preference to have the same spin for neighbors. But for computer science, there are simpler systems like this Fibonacci two-dimensional that you have zeros and ones, and there are no two neighboring ones. So we could try to store information in such system. I will talk about it. So for this purpose, they are Markov fields. What does it mean? It means that the probability of this question mark, depending on the or blue fields values, are in fact depend only on the neighboring ones, the green dots. Here probability distribution inside depends in fact, based on the blue line, depends in fact only on the green values. Here we can perform this kind of scanning that we scan line by line and use the probability distribution of the already decoded known values, that the blue values, and it turns out that we don't have to know all of them, but only the green one. So we scan line by line and use only the green one for the conditional probability distribution for the question mark position. So to get such a model, we will use maximal entropy random walk, which allows to find the probability distribution of pairs of such rows, for example, here. So we approximate this lattice with row of width w, and we look at two neighboring values in this of such row. So we have w times two shape, and we can find probability distribution inside it for given constraint statistical behavior, for example, Ising model, using maximal entropy random walk. I will talk about it. And then we can translate it into probability distribution inside such shape, this of size 5. So it allows us to use conditional probability distribution. So knowing only the green ones, we have the probability approximated for the question mark value. So having such model, we can perform scan and for each position use, let's say, these four neighbors to get the probability distribution of question mark, generated with this probability, for example, randomly or maybe using entropy coding for to store some information, and then we imagine this way that each position was generated this way, so what allows us to calculate, for example, some average entropy, energy. So here are some errors of various for various parameters. AB is the size of this model. So here A and B are two. For one, it would be one dot here, one dot here. And we can see that the errors improves when we increase the width. So I will talk about it. And also connection with quantum mechanics, with time symmetry. This work is mainly in this archive paper, but also some other papers. Okay, so what is the Markov field? So we start with one-dimensional Markov process. So everybody probably knows here that probability of given value based on the entire history is in fact only depends on the last value. So this is simplest order one Markov process. So it turns out that we can use equivalent formulation like here. That probability that values in two positions, the black dots, determine probability distribution inside. So the green values are the probability distribution are determined by the black dots. So we could in standard Markov we could just fix some value in the future. So this is symmetric formulation, and it restricts the ensemble of paths, and in this restricted ensemble. It is exactly the probability distribution in this gray region. So this is an equivalent formulation with this Markov property, which is nice because we can easily generalize it into higher dimension. So here we have that the values at the boundary of a region determine probability distribution inside this region. You can easily take it to higher dimension. So here is simply a Markov field. that values at the boundary of some region determine probability distribution inside this region. So this is kind of global condition. You can also get to local condition. For example, here that the probability distribution is for given node depends only on its neighbors. So this is kind of so here we have that for given value, if there are ones on the nearest, we have to use zero. So here, if we have four zeros at neighbors, then the probability distribution of zero inside is equal 1/2 as for one. So this is this for this Markov property becomes just one half when we have four zeros around. So we can use zero or one. Okay, so this is Markov property, and it turns out that it's equivalent with this Gibbs random fields like Ising model. So in Ising model we defined some probability as exponent of minus some beta thermodynamical times energy of given configuration, defined as sum over let's say potential over a neighbor. So we say that if neighboring spins have the same direction, then the energy is negative. If they are opposite, then it is positive. And we use this Boltzmann distribution among all configuration of such lattice. So getting, for example, Ising model. So the clique is, in the simplest case, is just neighbors. So we can use larger cliques, but this is usually this is just neighboring values. So we get this nice equivalence. It's called the Hammersley-Clifford theorem, which says that both they are equivalent, but they give some very different perspective, which are somehow complementary. So from one side we can see that we have some Boltzmann distribution over all possible configurations. So for computer scientists, the Boltzmann distribution is like in softmax in machine learning. From the other, we have this Markov property that values at the boundary determine probability distribution site here or here. Okay, so here are some Ising model simulated from this link. So if there is no interaction, we have nearly IID identical dependent identical variables 1/2 1/2. Then we can see some ferromagnetism that there is some preference for having the same neighboring values. So here is some weak preference, stronger. So finally there is a phase transition which says that they nearly all form domains of the same spin. So here we have the same energy in vertical and horizontal direction. Here there are change. For example, here we can see that in horizontal direction we have preference of having the same spins. In vertical we have preference to have the opposite spins. Here we have a continuous value, and so it can be used for computer scientists to generate some nice textures. Okay, so another application for computer scientists is image segmentation. For example, we have some noisy image and would like to segment it into some regions. So it is usually done with some bias assumption. So for each region we have some Gaussian of values. However, we need to add some prior. That means that in which types of distribution you would like to focus on. So here you like to focus on distributions which have the same labels in neighboring pixels. So if one pixel is, let's say, yellow label, then the neighboring pixels should also have larger probability of having yellow label. So this becomes exactly this Boltzmann distribution as in Markov field. So they are thought to be used in this kind of image segmentation to focus only on this distribution having more likely the same labels for neighboring pixels. Okay, so let's derive the basic formula for finding probability distribution inside such such Boltzmann distribution among paths. So we have some one-dimensional Ising model. We have energy of given path are given as sum over energy of neighbors inside. We define this transfer matrix as exponent of minus beta times energy of pairs. Then we would like to find probability distribution inside such sequences, assuming Boltzmann distribution among paths, infinite paths over this one-dimensional lattice with energy given by these formulas, sum over energies over the pairs. So from one side, having this transfer matrix, we can look at its powers. So combinatorially, power m to power l of index ij is sum over paths of length l starting in I ending in j. So from combinatorial perspective by this matrix product formula, we get this kind of behavior. So we have this Boltzmann distribution among paths of length L. From the other side, we have this Frobenius-Perron theorem saying that this kind of matrices for connected acyclic graphs usually have a unique dominant eigenvector. So we have this m psi equals lambda psi. And the other lambdas, the other eigenvalues are smaller, have a smaller absolute value. So this way, if you look at this m to power l, asymptotically for large l, we only see this dominant eigenvector. So asymptotically, it becomes lambda to power l times this projection over this dominant eigenvector. So we can also write in this bracket formulation from quantum mechanics. Okay, so now having this behavior that we have asymptotic behavior of these large powers which contain Boltzmann distribution among paths, we can find stochastic propagator. So for stochastic propagator, we can look at this diagram. That we would like to look at probability of neighboring ij values. So if in given time we are in I position and in the next time you are in j position, we jump to j position, divided by the probability of being in I vertex. So this is the stochastic matrix that if you are in vertex I in given time, what is the probability distribution of jumping to some vertex j in the next moment? So, using Boltzmann ensemble, we have this nominator becomes MIJ, so this one step to vertex J times very long ensemble of very long paths towards paths. So we take M to power L, which contains this ensemble, and take the limit L to infinity. In the denominator, we have nearly the same, but the first step is fixed, that it has to go to J. So it is not fixed. So the denominator is quite similar, but we have ensemble of one step further. So using this asymptotic formula, we get this kind of probability distribution. So this is the probability distribution of stochastic propagator of maximal entropy random walk. So this is random walk which maximizes entropy rate, that means average entropy per step, or just assumes uniform or Boltzmann distribution among paths on a given graph. So this is its propagator, and the stationary probability distribution can be found by finding dominant eigenvector of this above propagator, or we can just look at this diagram, and in this diagram we get that the probability of being in given vertex I is that, so we have the infinite paths this way toward left and toward right. So we go L steps toward left and L step toward right and perform limit L to infinity, And from these asymptotics, we see that these powers, in fact, only see this dominant eigenvector. So asymptotically, we get this psi I square. So we get, it's called Born rule in quantum mechanics, but you can see that also here in just Ising model, we have also this Born rule, which can be imagined that we have that given moment is kind of propagator from minus infinity and plus infinity. So here it's spatial. In the physics, we would like, in quantum mechanics, we'd like that it's temporal from minus past, from past and from future. Okay, so we see that for one dimensional case we can find then the stochastic propagator, the stationary probability distribution, by finding dominant eigenvector of this transfer matrix. So it's relatively simple. So this matrix grows quickly. So we have this W width stripes. So the size of this matrix will grow 2^W square matrix. So there are quite large matrices, but it's doable for width like 15, maybe 20. We can also find the probability distribution among a longer sequence, not only one or two like here. So we get this Born rule for Ising model. Okay, so here is this motivation from computer science perspective. So we have these Fibonacci numbers, yeah. So that we take two numbers and sum them, and then you get the next number, and so on. They have this asymptotic behavior, golden ratio to power n, and Fibonacci number. So the problem from the computer science perspective, a kind of basic problem, is encoding with constraints. That we would like to store information in sequence of zeros and ones without using two neighboring ones. So this is kind of the simplest constraints on the encoding sequence. So how to do it? So there is this Fibonacci coding that while in standard binary system, if you would like to encode some given value like this 73, we find the largest power of 2, so here is 64, subtracted and so on. So then we represent the values as positions, as the number of these powers of 2. So we have 64 is this one, 8 is this one, and the final one is this one. So we can analogously do for Fibonacci numbers. So again, we get 73 equals largest Fibonacci number, at most 73 is 55, plus another one after subtracting this 55, and so on, and we get this representation. So in this representation, we have this certainty that there are no two neighboring ones, because we are going from the largest number. So if there would be two neighboring ones, then earlier we would use one and the higher position. Yes. So by construction, we have certainty that there are no two neighboring ones, and this asymptotically it gives the proper proper capacity. So without constraints, we would have 1 bit per position. Here, with this kind of constraints, we get down to 0.69 bits per node. So we get this Fibonacci coding. So it is nice construction, but kind of limited. So from one perspective, you only encode into one large natural number. So what for a large long sequence of bits is not practical. We could replace it with entropy coder, with switch encoder, with decoder. So we would like to change it into a stochastic process that after one we have to use zero, but after zero we have some probability distribution among using zero or one in the next position of such sequence with no two neighboring ones. So we talk about it, and the motivation is, for example, that if you would be able to get it into two dimensions, so we would increase capacity of hard disk, for example. So imagine we have a hard disk and where we store information in every position by magnetizing or not magnetizing a given this circle, magnetic dot. So we could squeeze this lattice. If you squeeze it by square root of 2, then they touch on the diagonal, However, we get this kind of constraint as for Fibonacci, that we cannot use two neighboring magnetic dots, yes, in horizontal or vertical direction. So from one side we have more dots. We have more dots by square root of 2 squared. So we have twice more dots asymptotically. However, such dot carries less number of bits per dot. So in one dimension it was 0.69 bits per node. In two dimension it's this value 0.58789, and so on. So this value is known, I think, like 80 digits. It's not analytically known. It's called R-squared constant. It's not analytically known, but is very well approximated. So we would like to work close to this value, and in this case, for this situation of this condensing lattice, we get twice more nodes, each having 0.57 bits per node. So we get finally 17% improvement of the capacity of such hard disk. Yes. So this hard disk on the right would have 17% more bits per more bits than the one on the left. So this is thanks to more precise positioning of this head of this hard disk, and you need to perform this complex encoding. So it's not very simple, but in theory we could improve capacity of this by using more dense lattice with the same size of the magnetic dot. Okay, so let's look at this simpler case for one dimension. So we have this one-dimensional Fibonacci coding. We would like to change it into a stochastic process. That because the Fibonacci coding is not very useful for very long sequences. So we know that after one we have to use zero. Yes. So this is the constraint. But after zero we could use or zero or one. So the question is, what probability should we use? What Q should we use? So a standard natural assumption is one half, yes. So it is said that it maximizes entropy. Yes, one half maximizes entropy. However, it maximizes entropy for one step. Here we would like to maximize mean entropy. It's called entropy rate. So what does it mean? So we'd like to maximize entropy given this way. So this is entropy in one step, channel entropy in one step from vertex I, but we need to weight it, average it over probability distribution of being in given vertex. So we need to average it over the stationary probability distribution of given stochastic matrix. So the problem is that we have some constraints here, what we can do. For these constraints, we need to find the stochastic matrix such that and find its stationary probability distribution, for example by finding dominant eigenvector, such that it maximizes an entropy rate. So this formula in this case it's quite simple. So in from vertex one we don't produce any entropy because we have to go to vertex zero, so we only produce entropy from vertex zero. So from vertex zero we have you need to multiply the probability of being in vertex zero times entropy produced from this vertex zero, and so we get this kind of formula for entropy depending on the Q, the chosen Q. So for one half it's close to maximum, but it's not maximum. We can see that the maximum is a bit towards right. So maximum is for 0.618, as in the golden ratio. Why? Because we have this trade-off here. So going toward one half, we increase entropy produced in this one step. However, the we are more often in the state one, and from state one we don't produce any entropy. So this is this trade-off of reducing a bit the probability of state one at cost to be more often in state zero. At cost of producing a bit less information from state zero. Okay, so this is kind of finding trade-off. So here it's not very practical way, but this maximum entropy random walk we have derived on the beginning allows to find this stochastic matrix as I have written earlier. So finding the dominant eigenvector of this M matrix, we can easily get this stochastic matrix, which maximizes entropy production by using uniform probability distribution among possible sequences. So yes, so we have this space of sequences with no two neighboring ones, this Fibonacci constraint. And in this space, we assume uniform probability distribution and encode in one of them maximizing entropy. So we assume uniform probability distribution among these all sequences agreeing with the constraints. Okay, so this is entropy maximization. The standard random walk maximizes entropy for one step. MERW maximizes average entropy production. So average over the probability distribution, stationary probability distribution. Okay, so here are some approximations for this one-dimensional Fibonacci coding case. Yes, so we would like to write information in such sequence, such lattice of zeros and ones with no two neighboring ones. So here is one approximation that we can split this lattice into two independent lattices. For example, here are these black even and odd positions, black and white positions. So focusing only on the, let's say, black positions, there are no longer constraints, because constraints only work between these two sublattices. So only in black lattices we can just put some probability distribution of using one in given position. So this way we get Shannon entropy per position bits in every black field of this lattice. However, then we would like to fill the white positions, yes, and so we can choose 0 and 1 only if there are four zeros around, yes. So the probability of four zeros around is 1 minus p to power 4. So this is divided by half, because the number of these white fields is one half of all positions. Then with that, there is hidden entropy of one half one half. So if we can, then we use one half one half zero and one. So we store one bit, if only we can store, have some freedom. So this way, maximizing over this p, we get 0.566 bits per node. The optimal is a bit larger, like 4% almost. So it's nice approximation, very simple, but it's not perfect. So here is try of another approximation. So here you would like to choose some order, random order among all the positions. So choosing random order among positions in lattice, infinite lattices, seems difficult. But we can do it by imagining that every node has some random value of, let's say, from 0 to 0, 1. So for each node, we take random real value from 0 to 1. We can imagine that something like this was done. And then we try to choose values of these positions over this assigned random values. So in time t, you'd like to have assigned all the values up to t. Yes? So in time t percentage of nodes already have chosen values. So we can now choose some charging profile. I call it charging profile, q of t, that for in time t we use this q of t probability of using one in given position. And it there corresponds this a of t function, which says what is the probability that we can use we have freedom in given time. So if there was one the neighbor already set, then we cannot choose. So at the beginning this a, so here is this a, at the beginning this a is one. We can, there are no constraints, we can do whatever we want. However, at the end this a is changes. So this is from Monte Carlo simulations. It goes to approximately one half. Okay, so also the discharging profile. So at the beginning, nearly optimal was like 0.25, a bit smaller. At the end, it should go to one half, because one, if there are the nodes set at the end no longer constrain the further nodes. Yes, so at the end we should use one half like here. Yes, so this way we get also some approximation, which is not much better than here. However, this is a nice way to to take a random order over a lattice. Okay, so here is how it was done optimally in this paper. So it was my original paper, which introduced both asymmetric numerical systems and maximal entropy random walk from. It was 2006. It was my master thesis in physics. So okay, so we approximate the lattice as in the first slide with finite width. So instead of taking this infinite lattice z squared, we take lattice z in one dimension, this horizontal, and finite m w in this vertical direction, and we can choose different boundary conditions. You could choose, for example, zero as the boundary conditions, or you could choose cyclic boundary conditions. So one give bound for the entropy from the below, the second from above. So it could be used this way. Okay, so now we look at such neighboring stripes. Yes, so we have this. We have each stripe cannot have two neighboring ones, and then we can look at space alphabet of stripes, and then we can look at two neighboring stripes. And you'd like to choose one-dimensional Markov process in the space of these stripes in this large alphabet. So here is some formula. So we take two neighboring stripes, so here diagonal, and using this maximal entropy random walk formula, we get the probability distribution over these two neighboring stripes. We marginalize some over these star positions, and then take this conditional probability distribution of this one here under condition of this u0 u1 v0 v1. Yes, so this way we get this kind of algorithm. So here is the simplest one that we don't look at any context, and it says that it's a scanning when we have freedom. That means that there are not ones. There is no one at the neighbors, then we should use one using this probability. Here is this order one method. So now it looks at one neighbor toward past, one neighbor toward future, and it we have four probabilities, and we choose one of them depending on this on these two values. Yes, here order two. Now we have four time form. Probabilities which are from maximal entropy random walk, and here are the entropy. So this is entropy. How much entropy we have lost by this approximation? So here this is logarithm log 10 of the difference. So here is 100 bit worse. So this one is 100 bits lower than the optimal. This one is 110,000 approximately. This one 100,000 approximately. So here after using 2^5, so 1,000 values algorithm, you get approximately 10^-9 error redundancy of such algorithm. So it seems that we can get as close as we want to this optimal entropy for this problem of increasing capacity of hard disk. So here it is used for this for Ising model. So analogously, so previously we had these hard constraints that we can use cannot use two neighboring ones. So in Ising perspective, we could see that two neighboring ones have infinite energy, what makes them forbidden in Boltzmann distribution. But we could use it also in this Boltzmann distribution. It is in this archive at the first slide. Okay, so we again we look at the two neighboring stripes and find the probability distribution on them using maximal entropy random walk formula. This formula, but finding the dominant eigenvector of the transition matrix. A transfer matrix and use this formula, then we marginalize to get this probability distribution of the question mark under condition of these green positions, and so on. Then we can use the scanning, assuming that every node was generated in this this invariant way. So every node is treated the same way. So we can perform this kind of averaging over the context to get average entropy or energy. So using this translational invariance. Okay, this is kind of alternative way in comparison to Monte Carlo, which is kind of standard way to generate this kind of configurations. So for example, in this most popular metapolis Hastings, you have some configuration and you would like to modify it to a different configuration. So we choose some probability distribution among configuration. It is given by this Boltzmann distribution. So if we change only slightly, like one node, then we can easily calculate this division. Why the entire probability is very difficult to calculate. And this is the probability of transition. So if we say that taking a random position, if we can, we switch it to the opposite value here, then we have the same. This division is one. So here it can be done to make it one. So this way you get this for this two dimensional Fibonacci. You get this rule that we take a random position, check if four neighbors are zeros. If so, then we switch this central position to minus, flip 0 to 1 or the opposite. So this is Monte Carlo is very very universal. We don't need to know the we can just take the energy and just apply it. However, it's relatively costly. We need to perform it like 10 times per node, approximately. After performing it many times, we assume that indeed the new field is uncorrelated with the previous one. What is approximation? We don't really control these approximations. So the question is if you could use let's say this kind of methods to improve it. For example, we find this kind of scanning algorithm and perform this kind of scanning and use it as such random configuration, or maybe as a starting point for Monte Carlo to improve such configuration. This kind of algorithms bring some hope for improving especially speed of Monte Carlo. So here are some algorithms for this Ising model. For example, here we look at one value on the left and below, and get this kind of probability on using up or down for this J. So this is very weak ferromagnet. This is stronger ferromagnet. This is closed into the transition value. So I would also like to briefly talk about Markov type. So Markov types is kind of the probability distribution of patterns of such lattice. For example, here we have some configuration on a torus like here, and we would like to ask what is the probability distribution of given set of values on given shape like L here. Yeah, so Markov type can be seen as we have some we choose some shape in one dimension, is for example two neighboring, and ask what is the probability distribution of values over this shape. So for example, for this cyclic shape, you have two zeros appear once, 0,1 equals 1,0 appears twice, 1,1 appears zero times. Yes. So in this kind of Markov types, as this probability distribution of patterns over a given lattice, we have some conservation laws like here, that if you have zero, then no matter so zero and something, anything on the left, and zero, anything on the right, should have the same probability, because this is just a probability of zero. Yes. So we have some conservation laws. So this probability distribution over these shapes have some constraints. So these conservation laws, and we have this normalization that sum of these values has to be the length of the size. So we can normalize it and treat it as probability distribution, saying that sum has to be one. Yes. Okay. So what is interesting that we could choose all the probability distribution of given constraints. That means normalization summing to one, and satisfying the conservation laws, and we get some convex polytope, and in one dimension it turns out that all the points inside this convex polytope can be achieved. So we can find configurations which approach the given point. Yes, so what is interesting that in two dimensions it's no longer true. So it is here's example from this paper with Markovsky. So for heat is for two dimensions and the shape is 2x2 lattice. So we would like to ask what is the probability distribution over such shape of 2x2. So we have 16 possibilities. So this is 16 dimensional probability distribution. So we have one constraint that all the probabilities over these 16 values have to sum to one. We have also this conservation laws, and it turns out that we have 5 conservation laws here. So they allow us to generate all the remaining. So this is the largest set of independent conservation laws. So finally, you have 60-dimensional space, minus 1 for normalization, minus 5 for the conservation laws. So we have a 10-dimensional convex hull in 16 dimensions. We can combinatorially find its extremal points of this convex hull here. Yes? So we can combinatorially find these extremal points, which are, there are 21 in this case here. So here are all the convex points, extremal points of this convex hull. 21, and what's interesting that each of them corresponds to some periodic tiling. Yeah? So for example, here we have one. So all the white nodes. Yes. Yeah? So we have periodic tilings of all the white nodes. Here we have periodic tilings of all the black nodes. Here we have stripes, horizontal, vertical stripes. Here we have diagonal this checkboard. Yes, and so on. So we have some periodic tilings, periodic configurations. So we get kind of classification of periodic configurations. However, we can see that there are four these extremal points which have no periodic configuration, which have no tiling. We cannot find a configuration which gets to any of them. So we get a situation like here that the gray space can be approached with some lattices. However, there are some 4 points in this case, which cannot be approached. There is some complex structure between them. So it's interesting question how to find these complex structures. But generally, this is kind of automatic way to get classification of periodic tilings. Yes. Okay, so finally here is some remarks about maximal entropy random walk. So this random walk which maximizes entropy not for one step but average entropy production. Yes, so we have some graph. We would like to choose stochastic matrix on the graph. That means that it only uses the edges of the graph. So if MAB is zero, then SAB also has to be zero. And we have sum over the probabilities of outcoming edges has to be one. Yes. So we have to jump somewhere. The sum of probabilities has to be one. Yes. And we would like to find them. So for given stochastic matrix, we can find this stationary probability distribution over the nodes. and you would like to find this S matrix such that the entropy is maximized as average entropy average over the positional probability distribution. So the formula was found previously. So here is some examples. So here you have a lattice, Z2 lattice, I think 40 by 40, with certain boundary conditions. However, so in this case, for just regular lattice, it doesn't matter if you use standard random walk or maximal entropy random walk. However, for inhomogeneities, if we put some defects to this lattice, then there are huge differences, as we can see. So here the inhomogeneities, the squares, are removed self-loops. So usually we have self-loops and some vertices don't have self-loops. So the squares means that the node has degree 5. Without them, then the square has degree 4. If there is square, there is degree 5. Without square, it's degree 4. Okay, so here is some density after 10 steps, starting with some point inside this ball. So we can see that there are kind of similar for standard random walk and for maximal entropy random walk. However, after 100 steps, we can see that there are large differences. Yes. So, and after 1,000 steps, we have approximational probability distribution, which are completely different. It's not a random walk. It is nearly uniform. It doesn't have localization property. For maximal entropy random walk, it has strong localization. The density, the walker, mainly is in this region. So it's called also Lifshitz sphere, largest region without defects, but this is heuristic. Fine, proving anything about it is quite difficult. Okay, so we have kind of two philosophies. So in one, the walker like this drunken sailor sits in every vertex and toss a coin and based on that chooses some probability for the next step. In MERW, it's a different philosophy. So here we don't assume that the walker uses the probabilities. Instead, we assume that this is a safest model without full knowledge. So we assume that the walker performs some dynamics, but we don't know this dynamics, so we choose the safest model, the entropy maximizing model, as in Jane's maximal principle, and we have this kind of different behavior. The question is what physics says, and we will see that for a semiconductor, for random walk of electron, it's this picture. We have this strong localization, Anderson localization. So there are quite different philosophies. So GRW assumes that indeed walker uses these probabilities approximately, and in MERW we assume that this is only some effective model used by us. I don't assume it that the walker indeed uses this MERW formula directly. Okay, so why entropy maximization is interesting. So here is this Jane's principle of maximal entropy, that if you have some sequence of length n of zeros and ones, then we would like to focus on sequences of different proportions of zeros and ones. Yes, so we have sequence of length n, but with p n ones and the remaining zeros. Yes, so focusing on such subsets of sequences, the number is this binomial, which asymptotically, just substituting to Sieving formula, you get this approximation that asymptotic behavior of this binomial is 2 to power length times Shannon entropy. Yes. So what could you use it for? So from this Jane's principle of maximal entropy perspective, we could say that having only sequence of zeros and ones and not knowing what is the probability distribution of zeros and ones, the safest assumption is 1/2-1/2, because it maximizes entropy, because such focusing on such a space of sequences, we get subset which grows the fastest. So focusing only on these sequences of 1/2-1/2 zeros and ones, their family grows faster than for any other family. So it completely asymptotically dominates the remaining. So this is the safest assumption, because knowing not knowing anything about these parameters, if we focus on these parameters, they will completely dominate all the remaining parameters, the families of the remaining parameters. So it's kind of the safest assumption in this limited knowledge situation. So while limited knowledge, the best assumption is probability distribution which maximizes entropy, because it represents to a family which grows fastest. The entropy is the exponent in the growth, in the size behavior. Okay, so here is some another derivation of this MERW formula. So we would like to use uniform or Boltzmann probability distribution among paths. In standard random walk, we say that all length one path are equally probable. In MERW, we say that all length sides of going to infinity paths are equally probable. So we can see MERW as a limit of GRW for this length going to infinity. Okay, so as in the beginning, so we can say that the asymptotic behavior of this m to power t uses only this dominant eigenvector because of this Frobenius-Perperon theorem, saying that usually you have dominant eigenvector. So calculating the probability distribution of value inside a path, so we have an ensemble of paths, and we are interested in this probability distribution in some time t. So we take paths from minus t to plus t, and go to t to infinity. So we get this summation, thanks to asymptotic behavior, becomes just this Born rule. So we get this Born rule using this dominant eigenvector of transfer matrix, adjacency matrix, which turns out to be like in minus energy in Hadamard model, and the stochastic propagator is like here. Okay, so let's look at that we get to this discrete Schrödinger equation using this maximal entropy random walk. So having a lattice, one-dimensional lattice, with self loops, some of which are RMU. So usually we have self loop, however some of them are RMU. If the potential is one, then we RMU the self loop. So here is length 1000 lattice with cyclic boundary conditions, and there are RMU some self loops, one and two and three. Three self loops are RMU. And we look at stationary probability distribution. In standard random walk, GRW, you'd have nearly uniform stationary probability distribution. In MERW, we need to solve this eigenequation, lambda psi equals m psi. So here, m psi is the left neighbor plus the right neighbor, plus the same if there is self-loop, so if there is no defect, so one minus potential. Now, if we subtract 3 psi from both sides, multiplied by minus 1, we get this formula, which can be seen as discrete stationary Schrödinger equation, as here is Laplacian. So this is discrete Laplacian, which in continuous limit becomes a continuous Laplacian. So we get kind of Schrödinger equation. So solving it, we get the stationary probability distribution being mostly in this largest gap without defects. Yes. So usually our rocker is here, like million times more probability than being killed. So this is very strong localization because of using maximum entropy random walk. For standard random walk, there is no localization, nearly no localization here. Here is some evolution. It mainly looks at this ground state. So we indeed go to the quantum ground state in this formulation. So here we have maximized lambda. However, if you look at energy is 3 minus lambda. So maximizing lambda means minimizing energy, as in physics, quantum mechanics, because energy is minus lambda. This was stationary probability distribution as the quantum ground state. here are also the higher eigenstate. So here we have eigenvectors. Here is this lowest eigenvector. It's all positive. So all the these psi amplitudes are positive here. For the next one, first excited eigenvector, we can see that there is this white region. It means that the sign is changed. So one part is positive sign, the remaining is negative sign, because it has to be orthogonal with this first eigenvector. So it cannot be all pluses. Here we have three regions of different signs. So let's say this is plus, this is minus. So here are the first four eigenvectors, and what we can see in the evolution that after 100 steps we are similar to this first excited step, excited state. Yes, so we are not far from this ground state. We are in the first excited state, then we de-excitate into the ground state. Yes, so we can see that indeed. If starting close to the excited state, if overlapping with excited states, then we go to this excited state, then finally decay into this ground state. So we get kind of this quantum behavior, but the excited states are not stable here. They excitate into the ground state. But also in physics, if you have excited atoms, it will de-excite. Schrödinger quantum mechanics say it should be stable, but it excites because of interaction with environment. We can also take this continuous lattice, change uniform distribution of paths to Boltzmann distribution, and you get standard Schrödinger equation in continuous limit. So this is kind of quantum mechanics from perspective of random walk. So from practical perspective, we have this lattice of semiconductor. So we have lattice of silicon with some dopants, some atoms, single atoms of different types, and we are interested what is the probability distribution of finding electron in given position. So what kind of random walk? How does this random conductance inside some such semiconductor looks like? So if you assume standard random walk, we get nearly uniform probability distribution. So in this perspective, if we put some potential, then electron will flow. So this would be conductor. So standard random walk would say that this defective lattice is a conductor. But we know from physics that it's not true. Semiconductor is often not a conductor. So in both in quantum mechanics and maximal entropy random walk, we get this kind of localized situation. So if we put potential here, then we see that they cannot really flow because they are prisoned in this entropic wells here. Yes, so here is how physics look like. So we have again some semiconductor from this paper, and look at the probability distribution of electrons by this tunneling microscope, and we can see that it's closer to this MERW random walk than standard random walk. So we can see that for electrons, it's rather maximal entropy random walk. It's rather not standard random walk. So this is a practical application. However, for large objects, I think it's often standard random walk. Okay, so to summarize this part. So here is how the Born rules appear in maximal entropy random walk. So let's imagine you have the simplest infinite potential well, 0, 1. What stationary probability distribution should we expect? Standard random walk would say uniform probability distribution. Quantum mechanics says sine square. It's localized. So MERW also says sine square. Yes. So standard random walk, if the walker thinks locally, any diffusions, any chaos, we would have uniform distribution. MERW gets this sine square, this localization, because of using ensemble of complete paths. So if you use only paths from past or only from future, you'd get sine without the square. To get sine square, that is Born rule, in Ising model or here from MERW temporal direction, we kind of need to multiply these two one-directional paths. So to get given position, we need to get it from the past and from the future. So we get this, we need to multiply both the amplitudes. So amplitudes is kind of the situation at the end of propagator from the past or from the future. To get some probability, to measure some value, we need to multiply both and the amplitude. So this is the intuition from Born rule in Ising model or in MERW, that it comes from time symmetry. Having Born rule, we can violate this Bell-like inequality. So these are inequalities which seem completely obvious. However, for probability distributions with Born rule, we can violate it. So this Born rule is very non-intuitive for us. So this is the simplest case. So it's called Mermin's inequality. So we toss three coins, and intuitively tossing three coins, at least two of them need to have the same value. Yes, this is absolutely obvious. However, in quantum mechanics or in MERW, you can violate this kind of inequality. So here is a simple derivation that whatever probability distribution we choose on these 2 to the power 3, 8 possibilities, if we sum these three probabilities, we get at least one. So whatever probability distribution we choose, we get at least one. So this is completely obvious inequality. But however, if you have this Born rule, you can violate this inequality. So let's choose some amplitudes. So it is chosen to maximize the violation. So we choose amplitudes that for this 0, 0, 0 and 1, 1, 1, the amplitude is 0. So having this amplitude chosen, then the probability of getting A, in Born rule, here we first add amplitudes, then make the square. Again, add amplitudes over the unmeasured variables, then make the square. And normalize it, dividing by sum over all the possibilities. And here we get 2/10, so we get the violation. We get smaller than 1, we get 6/10. Some probabilities, so we get the violation thanks of using the Born rule, that we sum amplitudes over the unmeasured variables, make the squares, and normalize. So this Born rule is natural if thinking this symmetric way in Ising model or in Born or in MERW, but it is very non-intuitive. It leads to the violation of these kind of inequalities, like tossing three coins at least two are equal. So here is a realization of this violation for just Ising model. Yeah? So imagine you have this one-dimensional lattice of just three spins. So three spins have 2 to the power 3, that means 8 possibilities. Imagine that toward the left and toward the right, there is a sequence of these three spins which enforces this kind of amplitude. So it means that there is some interaction which forbids three ones and three zeros. So we have some kind of complex interaction which says that all are equally probable, but these two possibilities, all zeros and all ones, are forbidden. This is this psi which was chosen to maximize a violation of the Bell inequality. Doing that, here is some idealization of measurement. So here we measure these two variables, A and B, but we don't measure C. So we forget about C and only measure A and B. So this forgetting about C is crucial here, what does it mean that we measure something and don't measure something else? So if you would measure all three, then we would have to satisfy the inequality. So this is crucial that you have different type of interaction here. So for A and B, we have the value. So we say that it has to be fixed. A and B are fixed, are measured, and for C, we completely discard it. We don't, it's any value. So let's say it's there is no interaction on this spin C here. So this way we get this kind of Born rule and getting this violation. Here it is extended into these 8 possibilities. So in measurement we ask only about this A and B, the first two spins, and completely discard the C. And so assuming uniform probability distribution paths, the blue lines, then we get the probability of distribution over these four squares, the measurement outcomes, as being 2/10, source of getting the violation to six extent why it should be at least one. Yes. So having Bode rule, for example, in Ising model you can get Bode rule from spatial symmetry, left and right is the same. We can get violation of Bell-like inequalities. So finally having this symmetry, we can also get kind of quantum computers, but using spatial direction in Ising model instead of temporal direction in standard quantum computer. So here is an example of Shor's algorithm. So in Shor's algorithm, this basic example in quantum algorithm, quantum computing, we perform some superposition of 2 to the power n inputs. Then we perform some classical function, which is this power modulo n. We measure the value of this function. And what it does is that this original ensemble of 2 to the power n possibilities is restricted to only such values which give the same ensemble value, measurement value. Yes. So we have this ensemble, and here this ensemble of all values of these a variables become only values which give the same randomly chosen but fixed measurement outcome. And it's chosen such that this subset is periodic. And having this period, we have some hint about this for this factorization problem here. So this period can be obtained from with this quantum Fourier transform. So, but the crucial is that we in fact put the input of to our problem here, and get the output the solution for a given problem here. Also, there are these auxiliary variables which, if measured, they would spoil this ensemble, so it would keep the calculation. So we cannot just discard them. We need to uncompute them. So if in some future someone would measure these variables, he would cripple the calculation in the past. So this is a very time symmetric setting, short algorithm. Okay, so we could make something kind of similar in Ising model. So also we get this kind of producing superposition instead of Hadamard matrix using this X matrix, and here after it we get all 2 to the power number possibilities. So here is for three-set problem. So here we would like that all alternatives of triples are satisfied. So we fix on the right once as the alternative is equal gives one. So here is the alternative. So from one side we fix all the alternatives to be satisfied. From the left we choose all the possible values for variables. Oh, it's crucial that we use this not gates, that some variables has to be switched to the opposite values. And finally, we need to meet these left and right, so these propagators from the left and right, such that all these alternatives have the same variables. So here they would have some variables, but they can be different variables. And now we need to meet them. So in fact, it's done here. To make that all the variables in these alternatives have the same values. So if this kind of using symmetry should solve our three-set problem, which is NP complete. Yeah, so here is such view on this classical mechanic and quantum mechanics. Looking at these solid state systems, in first approximations, we would say that it has found the minimum of energy. Yes, the solid state system should find the minimum of energy. However, in the better approximation, you say that it is in Boltzmann distribution among possible energies. So we replace minimum used, for example, in quantum computers with ensemble, Boltzmann ensemble. So this replacing from with single minimum to ensemble is kind of going from simpler situation to Ising model, which kind of resembles quantum mechanics allows for Bohr rule, Bell violation for quantum computers, and also for classical mechanics we can look at similar transitions. So we start with classical mechanics has also a time symmetric formulation, which is the least action principle. And then we get to Boltzmann-Path ensemble. So we replace the minimization of the energy of action with ensemble, with Feynman ensemble. So this is kind of going from classical to quantum, from single optimal path, symmetric path to ensemble of paths. Yeah? So this is kind of transition from classical to quantum picture. If you do it also for Ising model, we can do Bell violation, we can do Ising computers. Okay, so this is the final slide. So we usually think in this directional way that we fix some value in the past and use, for example, Euler-Lagrange in classical mechanics or Schrödinger equation or stochastic propagator to evolve toward future. However, the question is if this is the proper perspective. So this perspective satisfies assumption of Bell inequalities. So assuming this perspective is called philosophical presentism, we can conclude inequalities which are validated by physics. So this assumption leads to contradiction in physics. So this is not the safest assumption. However, fortunately, we have this another assumption, this symmetric view on physics, that we have symmetric boundary conditions. For example, in the Big Bang in the past, and let's say in Big Crash in the future on infinity, or in the left and right in Ising model. So in classical mechanics, we have this action minimization, energy minimization in Ising model. In quantum perspective, you have this Feynman, Boltzmann, ensembles of paths, of diagrams, Feynman diagrams, scenarios. So this is time symmetric thinking. It's called eternalism from philosophy perspective. Two-state vector formalis, like this given moment is meets these two propagators from past to future. And this view, this symmetric boundary conditions, does not satisfy assumption of Bell theorem. So this view does not allow us to get to these inequalities which are violated by physics. So this way we can avoid this contradiction of Bell theorem by using symmetric view. Also here, if you would like to get on 0-1 range, not uniform probability distribution, like in standard random walk, standard chaos, but as in quantum mechanics sine square, then we need to use ensemble of full paths. We need to use symmetric picture. So this is general conclusion that we have strong arguments from, especially from Bell theorem, that physics is time symmetric. Also, for example, in Shor's algorithm. So there are many experiments like Wheeler's experiment, like delay choice quantum erasure, especially in Valbon's formulation. Also these asking photons where they have been. There are many experiments which kind of uses time symmetry. From quantum perspective, I think Shor is the best example. We literally add the problem on one branch, read the outcome on the other branch. We have these auxiliary qubits which measured later can cripple the calculation earlier. So in quantum mechanics there are many suggestions that uses time symmetry, and if you don't want to have this problem with Bell theorem, we should look at time symmetry, which is also in classical mechanics, also in the least action principle, also in Ising model. Okay, thank you.